Welcome to worship online at DeWitt Community Church for this weekend of December 26th and 27th. Before we begin this time of worship, I just want to share with you a few quick announcements. First, please continue to follow us daily on Facebook, where we offer support and encouragement, music, worship, daily devotions. Just go to our website, DeWittChurch.org. Second, our next serve date at the Samaritan Center is Sunday, January 10th. We're going to need two shifts of five volunteers to help prepare prepackaged meals for distribution. If you're interested in signing up or would like more information, please contact the church office either by email or by phone. And finally, I just want to say a special thank you for your continued generosity towards the ministry of our congregation. Your generosity allows us to continue doing ministry during this challenging time of the pandemic, and we are so thankful for your continuing support. You can make a donation by visiting DeWittChurch.org or send a check to the church office. And now, as we gather for worship online, Pastor Bill will be speaking to us today on a passage from the 90th Psalm.
Christian friends, rejoice with heart and soul and voice, giving heed to what we say. Jesus Christ is born today. Ox and ass before him bow, and he is in the manger now. Christ is born today. Christ is born today. Good Christian friends, rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now ye hear of endless bliss. Jesus Christ was born for this. He has opened heaven's door, and we are blessed forevermore. Christ was born for this, Christ was born for this. Good Christian friends, rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now ye need not fear the grave. Jesus Christ was born to save. Calls you on and calls you all to gain his everlasting call. Christ was born to save. Christ was born to save.
We are blessed beyond measure. Our gracious God not only gives us all that we need, but he also gave us the Son that he promised us, Jesus the Lord, which we celebrated at Christmas. Now we are thankful for all that we have, and we're also thankful for the blessings that God gives us through you. If you find it in your heart today to be able to give to the ministry here at DeWitt Community Church, we ask you to do so. And remember that those gifts are being multiplied for the kingdom of God. Would you please consider giving your gifts and tithes to God's church today? Let us pray together over these gifts. Gracious Lord, we thank you for these generous people. We thank you for their faithfulness, not only in giving of their tithes and offering, but of giving their whole lives to the ministry of this church. Help us to use your wisdom and your guidance to spread the good news of Christ throughout the world, today and always. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. I'd like to invite any children that are around to the room so they can hear the children's message this morning. Good morning, boys and girls. Thanks for joining us for worship. I want to ask you a really silly question this morning. Could you try to move your nose without moving your face like this? I guess I'm not really good at it. It's really hard to just try to move your nose without moving your face. Well, what about this? Have you ever tried to wiggle your ears without moving your face? I'm wiggling my ears. Can you see? It's really hard. I'm moving my eyebrows and my whole face. But what about this? Have you ever tried to lick your elbow like this? That's like really hard. That's like really hard. Those things are like really hard to do by yourself. You know, those may be silly things that are really hard to do by yourself without someone trying to help you in some silly way. But have you ever tried to do something that was really hard, that required all your strength or all your focus, that you needed someone's help? You know, maybe there's a difficult subject to learn at school, or maybe there's some problems at home, or you're having problems with your friends. You know, sometimes we need help. We can't always do things by ourselves. You know, in the Bible, it talks a lot in the Old Testament and the New Testament about how God is our help and our strength. Times that we may feel like we're really struggling or having a hard time, the Bible tells us that God is always there to lift us up. And so we wonder, how do we do that? How do we ask for God's help? Well, the easiest way we can ask for God's help is to pray. To pray to God, to close our eyes and say, "Dear God, I need your help." Or, "Lord, help me through this difficult time." You know, another way that God gives us help, believe it or not, is when we ask for it. If we ask our parents or our family or friends or even our teachers or even our pastors, people here at church, those are all people God gives us to be our strength and our help. Boys and girls, next time you try something really hard, and if you ever get frustrated or upset because you feel like you're by yourself, just remember, God always gives us help because God loves us. God is our strength. God is our hope. God is our love and Lord of our life. Let's pray. Dear God, help us in those times, in those days when we really struggle, that God, sometimes we feel like we have to do something by ourselves. But God, help us see that you are our strength. And God, you give us other people to be strong. Lord, help us as we try to live into your strength. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. I hope you have a blessed week, boys and girls.
Child, our welcome you to the service of the DeWitt Community Church on December 27th. It's a time of celebrating God's grace and goodness, anticipating what is to be a brand new year. We are just a few days from 2021. Many have said that we are about to end a year that is one of the most difficult in anyone's memory. And yet we anticipate in God's grace the capacity to look upon those things that have been provided for deliverance, for celebration, and for strength. We ask that God would watch over us as we move into this new time. Let us pray together. Gracious God, for your goodness that brings us all into the place where we can worship and share, that makes us family, that makes us a church that is outreaching to the ones around about us, that welcomes all people who would name the name of Christ and who would celebrate during this season of joy just completed, that we might indeed feel the presence of your strength and blessing as we move into a new season and a new year. In Jesus' name, amen. In the Psalms, number 90 to be specifically, we are told by this simple sentence, "Teach us, O God, to number our days." It seems to me that we have spent a good deal of time numbering our days as we reach this point where soon we will begin the numbers again. And those numbers have contained all kinds of reports to us about struggles and difficulties and loss and challenge and so much that is on the news in every possible expression that allows us to feel that the numbering of days is not something that is difficult to follow since it is done for us with great regularity. In the New Testament, in the book of 1 John, we read these words, "See how great a love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called children of God, and as such, we are." We are called the children of God. And so we come to this final Sunday of the year, if we think of this in terms of worship days in our mind's eye. We say to one another, "Joy to the world. Merry Christmas for the time past that was a celebration," recognizing that this is no doubt a most unique and different year for just about everyone, near and far. We thank you, Lord, that we can look upon those days as part of a string of celebrations that no doubt created for us an interesting departure to look back in days gone by, to celebrate in our memories the things that were different and that we loved and enjoyed. It's not a strange thing for many of us who have some years of experience to even go back to the thoughts of our childhood, of families that were made up of folks who have now gone into God's presence and blessing, that we remember with fondness that which made the season special. We can even remember when we were young again, and we can think about what it meant to move and be able to do the things that are more of a struggle today. And then for those who are little ones in our midst, they are making those memories that will one day be their experience as they come to remember what has happened. But we are reminded as we enter close to the season of the new year, that as any time we visit a memorial garden, a cemetery, we always see in that place again and again, and often mentioned, that there is a date on the left of that stone that reflects a family remembrance, and then there is another date on the right, and in between those dates is invariably a dash. And one might always, as often as said, think of life as a dash from one date to the next, but the reality is a life that has been lived in the presence of God viewed only as a dash rather than a culmination of so much good and so much fulfillment. We like to think of things past, but we also concentrate on things to the future. And now we are looking for hopefulness and positive expressions and deliverance and all the things that make life normal again which is what we all seek in our hearts and minds. Our human challenge is to make the most of our time on earth and to know how to do it. Life is not for us who follow after the faith of Jesus, a circle that ends with a never-ending spiral to the same thing. We don't concentrate on the bubonic plague and the misery of the flu of 1918 and then jump to our own present experience and say, one after another, with many others in between. We look to a future that sees what was the deliverance factor. And even as we look to the struggles that are presently being experienced, we understand much of what deliverance is all about. It's difficult for us to recognize that again and again in the Bible, and no doubt if we think about it in our own life experience, we are prone to be extremely forgetful when it comes to the blessings and deliverance of God when we are facing whatever the current struggle might be. If we go back far enough, all the way to the time of the Exodus, when Moses was called by God to deliver a people who had been in bondage for centuries and takes them from the misery of the life that they were facing and moves them on steps to the life of deliverance. And in that process, parts the Red Sea of all things. Imagine if we were standing there and could have imagined what it looked like. And then in the midst of the wilderness, there was manna provided so that they wouldn't starve, though there was complaints before they received it. But it wasn't a moment after Moses went up on the mountain to speak with God that the people apparently forgot the nature of their own deliverance by God's goodness. It seems impossible for us in our time to imagine the kind of magnificent act of miracle that God provided, and they, in such a short time, completely acted as though it had never happened. Do you remember in the Old Testament where David was coming upon the time when his armies were fighting against the Philistines, and he came up to the king and he looked and he saw that the Israeli leadership was fearful, for the giant Goliath stood before them, challenging the people to bring a champion to fight him. And David, as a teenage boy, goes up to the king and says, "I'll do it." Seemed like a foolish suggestion, and the king said so. But then David argued, he said, "You know, when I watched my father's sheep, I turned down a lion and I took a lamb from the mouth of a bear, and I can stand in God's name before Goliath." And I suppose in one way or another, they said, "Well, what have we got to lose? We can send the young man and see what happens." And we know how that story comes about. In the grace of God's deliverance, even though it's easy for the people to forget again and again. Do you remember Jesus' disciples? They stood with him when the crowds were gathered to hear him preach. And a time came for the meal of the day, and people were hungry. And he took a few loaves and a few fish, and he multiplied them and fed 5,000, and on another occasion, 4,000. And the disciples went around on one occasion, it's described, and they collected basket after basket until there were more than 12 baskets full of loaves and fishes after everyone had received all the amazing comfort of eating that could be provided. And it wasn't too many days later, when they became so worried about being hungry, they had completely forgotten about God's great deliverance to them in the miracle that Jesus provided. Now, we would like to say, would we not, that if we had ever been privileged to be standing there collecting 12 baskets full of bread and fish that came from this little handful that had been provided in the first place, that in all of our lifetime we would never forget such a thing. But the reality is, as human beings are prone to be, we often forget about the deliverances that have been normal and natural to our life experience of faith while we face the latest struggle that is before us as we move into the days that are before us. I have used the illustration myself to say, wouldn't it be great as a pastor to be able to stack up about a 50-foot-high pile of wood and dump water on it and do all the kinds of things that Elijah did when he was taking on the challenges of the God of Baal, and all those prophets and followers after that false god were doing all kinds of shenanigans to try to get God to rain fire down on that pile of sticks and show that God, that their God was the impotent and empowered possible leader of all humankind, and nothing happened. And then Elijah prays, and woof, God scoops up those branches and all the wood there and consumes them in fire. Boy, I'll tell you, if we could do that on the front lawn of the church, we'd pack the place out no matter what was coming once this virus gets over with, because people couldn't imagine such a miracle happening. And yet, you know, those folks forgot that in almost a short time. And we as a people are prone to the same thing, that the deliverance of God is gracious and good and fulfilling to us, and yet we can become so forgetful when it comes to those kind of passions. I must say, in an example that is more current to my own personal experience, it was about a year and a half ago that I went in to have some eye surgery done. As a result of that surgery, I haven't seen as well as I am looking at the present time since I was 25 years old. It's a miracle beyond description from my own experience. I admit I need to wear glasses now so I can read, where it used to be the other way around. But the truth of the matter is, it's miraculous. But you know, in all honesty, I take it for granted now. It's part of my living. It's part of who I am. And while I speak to you now to say praise God and thank him for the miracle of what he built into the human condition that allowed gifted physicians and those who can care for us to bring about change that is positive and miraculous, is it not so that we easily forget what happens to us? In the midst of all the gloom and doom that we see around us, we hear words from the book of 1 John. See how much God has loved us. God's love is so great that we are called God's children. So, in fact, we are. And we are. We are held here and now in the best of times and in the worst of times, to paraphrase Dickens, as we might say. And we know that the author of life has told us we are being held in his hand. The reality is, however, that that is not the sum total of what our experience is. We remember that we are not only being held by God's grace and his promise and his goodness, but we are also held responsible, because we are God's people called to stand in the presence of God's strength. It's not possible for us who have been blessed not to render and offer blessing to others who, in fact, need to hear good news, and to know that God's promise is not limited to the few, but to all who will call upon the name of the Lord. So we are God's children. And that is true for this moment and for tomorrow. For we know who holds the future. So if we declare that the future, which is sneaking up on us in 2021 in just a few days now, we know it's taken care of for the people of faith. What is important now is to live up to what it means to be a child of God in the present age. The righteous do what is right, we might say, as often is expressed in Scripture. And right action calls us to live in love with our brothers and our sisters, those who are near and those who are far, those who we can touch and those who we cannot because of limitations placed upon us for our own well-being. But there is always a place for us to stand firmly in prayer. I have shared with many of you the experience of my own grandmother, who in fact was a phenomenally gifted speaker. She had a reputation who could move folks with her words. She could make people laugh and cry depending on the circumstances and how she said it. And she could have a powerful influence in the church of which she was a part. But there came a time when she couldn't even go outside again, but she could always pray. And it became a sort of smiling celebration to our family how many people came to the house to pray with my grandmother, who somehow they felt had a special line to the Lord. And certainly she acted as though that were true in calling upon God's name for the support of every need and every circumstance imaginable. When we reach out to touch another, it is always in God's name. In Henry Nouwen's book, Reaching Out, he tells the story of a priest who canceled his subscription to the New York Times. The endless stories of fighting crime, political intrigue, and we would even add viruses of the worst order, he felt distracted from prayer and meditation. But Nouwen says this is a sad story because it suggests that only by denying the world, somehow you can live in it. A real spiritual life as we move into 2021 does the exact opposite. It makes us alert and aware to the world around us. It allows us to stand in the presence of God's goodness, knowing that there are needs that we can have an impact upon because we care about the people with whom we have immediate touch, and even those we may never touch, but God knows we care for them. Time and history in God's sight always has meaning. And while we have come through a time of renewed again and again celebration, where we have heard the old songs and we have heard the meditations and we have shared the grace that God alone provides in giving to us a new Christmas season that is now past. But as we look to these few days that will conclude a year that many would describe as the most challenging in memory, we would declare that time and history are going somewhere. And each of us is not only unique and significant, for every person, influential or great or small, very well educated or self-taught, in every experience offering to life, everyone is unique and special. And we have a significant part to play in our own lives in faithfulness and in the lives of the generation that we are living in. For this is our time. This is where we are. And this is the day in which God has called us to faithfulness and fulfilling of his will. We can look upon the overall sweep of history if we would study. And we have seen 1920 Christmas time come and go. And we will enter in to 2021, you can see how human capacities can fail us. 2021, a new life, a new time. Will your resolutions contain within them an attempt to be faithful in every opportunity that is afforded to you? And may we walk in faithfulness. May we walk together as a church family and as a community to be about the business of responsibility, knowing that we are held in the hand of God, and finding our strength and our hope in God's promise, and even in the midst of great challenges and hills to climb, we know that we are more than conquerors through the Christ who has loved us and whose birth into our lives has come in this past season once again to remind us how much we are loved. Let us pray. Gracious God, may we feel the presence of your Spirit and the power of your love and grace. May we understand that that belongs to us as heirs of your kingdom by your promise, and that at that same time you have given us the glory and possibility of the wonder of your goodness to serve our neighbor and our friend, our family who is dear and close to us, and those that are far from us, and even those who are unnamed by us, that we indeed might be the representatives and the light on the hillside that says that Jesus, who is the light of the world, can be seen through the love that we express. And may we gather the strength that comes from that faithfulness, and that you may bless us and multiply our effectiveness through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. And may the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Lord lift up his peace and give you strength as you enter into a new year and a new possibility of faithfulness through Christ our Lord. Amen.